Hey guys, today's lecture is going to focus on Stuart England, and this covers the time period from the beginning of the Stuart dynasty with James I in 1603 through the English Civil War, the interregnum period, and the rule of Oliver Cromwell, and the restoration of the Stuart dynasty until the death of Queen Anne in 1714. Our objectives for today are to explain how England developed into a constitutional monarchy during the rule of the Stuart dynasty, and also the development of what we call Great Britain. So I want to start with our early Stuart kings. In 1603, James I came to the throne and following Elizabeth. Elizabeth I, of course, was the last Tudor monarch, very well loved, and had only met with Parliament 9 times in 44 years. Interestingly, most of the Tudor monarchs knew how to work with Parliament to their advantage, even though they probably believed in absolute monarchy. James I had been the King of Scotland, and he didn't necessarily understand the idea that of Parliament. Plus, Parliament wanted more power. Parliament was increasingly controlled by the Puritans, and especially the House of Commons, and the Puritans didn't like James's friendliness towards Spain. And so we're going to see with James and Charles, the first two Stuart kings, a lot of policies that were just simply unpopular. So number one, especially James, but really the both believed in absolute monarchy. In fact, James wrote a tract called The True Law of the Free Monarchies that advocated divine right of kings. This didn't set well with Parliament, who believed that Parliament had the right to make decisions in England. Furthermore, the Stuart kings also often imprisoned their opponents. They used the Court of the Star Chamber, something that had been begun by Henry VII, to imprison people without fair trial. They also were pursuing a policy of friendship with Catholic Spain, and when they would actually, and even at times, these policies with Catholic Spain, just further infuriated the Puritans, who really had wanted to rid the church of Catholic influence, the Anglican Church. They also imposed taxes without the consent of Parliament, something that the Magna Carta had forbidden, and they also forced people to make loans to them. Probably, though, the greatest reason was their just persecution of Puritans, especially under Charles I. The Puritans, once again, were the group that wanted to purge the Anglican Church of Catholic influences and had become a significant portion of the middle class. Although only 10% of the English population were Puritan, because they had so much wealth, they dominated the House of Commons. The House of Lords was largely Anglican, and did not see eye to eye with them, but the House of Commons just gained more power throughout the century. In 1628, Charles I is going to be forced to call Parliament into session. He had been fighting a war and he needed more money, and he had been raising money illegally. And when he called Parliament into session, Parliament essentially said, "We're not even going to deal with you until you deal with our issues." And they forced him to sign the Petition of Right. The Petition of Right had several provisions. The first, that the king was forbidden to collect taxes or force loans without the consent of Parliament. Secondly, that he could not arrest or imprison his opponents without just cause. Thirdly, there would be no quartering of soldiers allowed. That was something that was going on during the time period where the king would quarter soldiers in people's private homes, and the people in those private homes had to pay for them. And lastly, there would be no military law unless they were actually at war in England itself. Because the king needed money, he signed this Petition of Right. However, he really had no intention to honor it, and the following year, he actually dismissed Parliament and ruled as an absolute monarch for the next 11 years. He went back to imprisoning his opponents without just cause. In fact, one of the taxes called ship money was part of your reading that was put on coastal towns in order to help raise money for the crown. He also antagonized the Puritans so severely during this time period that it became known as the Great Migration. And to give a little context to that, this was when the Puritans settled the Massachusetts Bay Colony. Several thousand fled England for a better life, although most did remain in England. However, by 1640, Charles is faced with a dilemma. Remember, like I said earlier, the Stuart kings were also the kings of Scotland, and at this point, England and Scotland were not unified countries. Charles had tried to push the English Book of Common Prayer on the Scots, who were mostly Presbyterian, and they did not like this and they rebelled. Because of this rebellion, Charles I needed money and he attempted to call Parliament into session. And when he called Parliament into session, Parliament essentially said, "We're not going to even talk about giving you money until you deal with these issues." His response was to dismiss Parliament, and this is known as the Short Parliament. It met a very short time. But it did not solve his money problems, and so he was forced to call them into session again, and this is called a Long Parliament. The textbook reading here is a little bit confusing because it advocates the idea that they met uninterrupted for almost 20 years, which is actually not true. In theory, there was a parliament that was constantly meeting, but at one point the parliament was purged of any supporters of the king, and then later was actually dismissed, although technically still in session. But I just wanted you to be clear of the idea when you see Long Parliament, they met for 20 years and that they didn't actually meet for that long. They did, however, meet long enough to form a vocal opposition to Charles, especially the House of Commons. Keep in mind there were some parliamentarians who did support King Charles, but the opposition to the House of Commons drafted something called the 19 Propositions, which was essentially a reformulation of the Petition of Right. The same demands, no military law, no taxation without the consent of Parliament, and frequent meetings of Parliament. Charles's response to that was to send his men to arrest the leaders of the House of Commons, and the leaders were in hiding, and this event in 1642 triggered the Civil War, the immediate cause of the war. And so as the war begins, we're going to talk about what exactly happened. One thing that I would do if I were you and you're preparing for this test is I would probably make my own little graphic organizer of the underlying cause of the war. What are the long-term events and what are the short-term events based on both the reading and what I've just talked about. As for the war itself, the two sides were the Cavaliers and the Roundheads. The Cavaliers were the supporters of the king, and the Roundheads were the supporters of the House of Commons, opposed to the king. Roundheads were led by an ardent Puritan by the name of Oliver Cromwell. They were mostly Puritans. Much of the middle class supported the Roundheads as well. The Roundheads also, led by Cromwell, had really advanced military techniques that called their New Model Army. They had modeled that on Gustavus Adolphus's army during the 30 Years' War, and because of this, they were actually able to successfully defeat the king's men. In fact, the Battle of Naseby in 1645 was the most decisive win, and by 1646 it was very clear that the war was over. At this point, however, Charles was arrested. Parliament was purged of Charles's supporters, and so the only supporters remaining, we call the Rump Parliament, the only ones remaining really were those that were opposed to the king. And they voted after the trial of Charles in 1648 to execute him. And in 1649, Charles I was executed, proven to the English people even though even the king was not above the law. This period where there was no king between 1649 and 1660 is called the Interregnum, or the interruption of the monarchy. Oliver Cromwell, that Roundhead leader, becomes the leader of the what we call the English Republic, and later takes the title Lord Protector, and he begins to enforce Puritan rules. He forbids card playing. He forbids dancing. Theaters are closed down. No more sports. Essentially, the English are supposed to focus on prayer. And this didn't go too well because, remember, the majority of the English were Anglican, and they were generally happy with their religion. Cromwell also took away land from the Irish and gave it to English landlords, absentee landlords, something that's going to cause a lot of issues later on between the Irish and the English. Interestingly, although Cromwell was an ardent Puritan and enforced Puritan reform, he did allow Jews to worship freely in England, something which is an interesting development, but he was trying to bring in Jewish skilled workers back to the country to help the economy. Cromwell ruled forcefully and was somewhat unpopular, and when he died in 1658, his son became the new Lord Protector. His son was not as forceful, and by 1660, the English were able to get rid of Cromwell, and restore the son of Charles I, Charles II. Charles II comes back, and he was very mindful of his father's fate, the fact that he had been beheaded. He allows Parliament to take control of the issues, And during this time period, for the most part, we see England restore itself. One thing that does happen, though, because of the Puritan influence, we see a lot of laws that became very anti-Catholic to get rid of the Catholic influence. This satisfied the Puritans and kept them from revolting, although the Catholics were not very happy about it. Also during this time period, we're going to see the formation or the establishment of the political parties in England. And the two big political parties would be the Tories and the Whigs. What had happened during this time and the formation of these parties was because of succession. Charles did not have any legitimate heirs to go to the throne, and the next in line was his brother, James II. James was an open Catholic, and this was really bothersome to many of the English people. The Tories defended the hereditary monarchy. They didn't like James, they didn't like his Catholicness, but they also believed that a hereditary monarchy was more stable, kind of following the ideas of Thomas Hobbes. The Whigs formed to exclude James II from ever taking the throne. Ultimately, the two parties compromised. The Whigs agreed to let James become king, and the Tories agreed to pass a writ of habeas corpus to protect the rights. Both parties believed James was older and he would most likely die pretty soon, and after that death, James's Protestant daughter could come and rule. However, James becomes king in 1685, and those plans don't quite work out. James was very Catholic, very openly Catholic. He ignored Parliament. He pronounced the ideas of absolute monarchy. And once again, the English Parliament was willing to deal with him. Basically, they felt he was going to croak. However, in 1688, James had a son. And now, with new James III in line for the throne, that would mean another 50 to 70 years of Catholic rule. That was too much for Parliament. They invited James's son-in-law, William of Orange, and his daughter, Mary, to overthrow James. The event known as the Glorious Revolution occurred in 1688 when William and Mary come back. And with this event that happens, we're going to see the signing of the English Bill of Rights. The English Bill of Rights will ensure that Parliament meets frequently and probably there are basic civil rights of the English, including rights of freedom of speech and freedom of press. Also, and most importantly, the English Bill of Rights would ensure that Parliament was supreme over the king. In addition, the Act of Settlements is passed, which would ensure that the king must be Protestant in religion. Catholics were excluded. And the Toleration Acts were passed, which allowed for all Christian sects except for Catholicism to exist, that way ensuring that the Puritans had the equal rights to the Anglicans. After the death of William and Mary, that an heir, Mary's sister Anne becomes queen. And at this point, she didn't have an heir either, and this is going to set in motion a series of issues. The most serious issue is what to do about Scotland. It was agreed that they would give the throne to some German cousins, but there was a very real fear that the Scottish would prefer a Stuart monarch. James III was living in exile in France. What happened in 1707 was England and Scotland united and formed what we call Great Britain, and this is where we see the beginning of Great Britain. After Anne's death in 1714, the throne will go on to the House of Hanover, Germans, and we'll talk about that in our next unit. I hope you've enjoyed this presentation, and please once again go over your own notes to clarify them and make sure they're in line with this.